Thank you very much for your introduction and for your warm welcome. It's a pleasure for me being here to present the developments in the German Engineering Association, VDMA, with a focus on plastics and rubber machinery. So, my Japanese is not so good, so I will speak English, and I also could not follow so good the recent presentations, but I heard sometimes Euromap, VDMA, and so it's really good that I can give an overview what is our usage of your great technology developed by the OPC Foundation. So I want to start with a look at the connected world. So we as VDMA have several branches, so they are like small associations within one association, and these have connections to the OPC Foundation. Then we have European Umbrella Association. In the case of plastics and rubber machinery, this is Euromap, and there behind are many other European national associations. Then we have contact to on the international level to other associations. In Japan, to JPM. In US, to plastics, TAMI, Taiwan, and in China, directly to the standardization organization. And this is also the case, for example, here for machine vision. They also have a European association and worldwide corporations. And everywhere are actions OPCOA. And as complicated as this slide looks like, it is in reality. The advantage of this is OPCOA is widely accepted as the machine-to-machine communication technology. There are many activities for the development of OPCOA specifications, so that the current task we have is we need some harmonization there. That means the different projects we have, which currently run in parallel, we got good experiences there, but now when we find out, okay, we define the same things again and again, it doesn't make sense. There are customers using machines of different types and they just want to access them in the same way, not with 100 different models. So, what will I tell you now? Just a short overview over the VDMA and then why we think it's really necessary to do standardization. Then I will tell you something about the activities of Euromap in the field of plastics and rubber machinery, then go to other activities within VDMA, and then a few words on this planned harmonization. So the VDMA headquarter in Frankfurt in Germany and is the most important industrial association in Europe. We have over 3,200 members, majority small and middle enterprises, but of course also the big players are members in VDMA. So we are structured in, as I mentioned, many sub-associations. We have regional subsidiaries and also international representations. And so we are also the host of several European sector committees. So for example, Euromap, it is a European association, but it is hosted by us in VDMA. So I'm not only working for VDMA, I'm also the director of the technical commission of Euromap. And so we can say really Euromap represents a broad machinery and the complete industry, so you find for almost all types of machinery a place within VDMA. So, why do we think we need standardization? So, what we are thinking about is the smart production of the future. New business models like digital market platforms, customer-specific mass production, we want to integrate all the machines and products from different manufacturers in one system, and you want traceability of data. You can do it just collecting data, just what format you get, and hope some artificial intelligence will match everything. But I think this is something for the future, perhaps. So really, to have this in an efficient way, we need consistent data. That means that the machines from different manufacturers deliver the data in the same way. And for this, OPC-OA is the favorite interface standard, because with this we really meet the requirements also of our mechanical engineering branch. So it is an open platform. We have security by design, as there was in one speech. Different protocols on the layer below are supported. We have this semantic description. So this is very important, that with this we can create the companion specifications really to get the information we want to exchange between the machines here in OPC-OA. And really that it is manufacturer independent, that we have this support also by the OPC Foundation is very important for us. So what we then do, we really focus on the development then of the companion specification. We are in contact, OPC Foundation also involved for the basic modeling and also with the harmonization group activities there to give our experiences also to the complete OPC Foundation, but we focus our work on this companion specification. You see this little girl with the remote control, so to say, okay, if you lose your specific remote control, you go to a shop or buy a universal one, and this hopefully works with all machines, with all televisions or DVD players or what else. And then you say, okay, this we can standardize, and then you have one remote control for us. But knowing there's still a place where the manufacturers can differentiate. So they say, okay, I have some additional functionality that, for example, some manufacturers say, okay, I press one button and I go directly to Netflix or something else. This is perhaps a specific comfort function. And here it's the same if some machine builder says, okay, I have some special applications, more functionality, then I can do vendor-specific extensions. This should be as small as possible. So if we say, okay, during development of such a standard, there's some data only some machines provide and others not, okay, then include them as optional, but then it's defined and not everyone does it as he thinks. So we had already this overview with our branches, which are all working on OPC-OA. I don't want to go in depth with the numbers because they change every month. So I think if you show this slide, it is in the same moment outdated, because this is all groups. Some are interested, some are already working, some have really already released, but really to show here, we have this variety of machines, and yes, more than half, they have only a few who think, okay, we are not interested or not yet ready to do this. So this will be, I think, in the future, all of the recent spots will become working groups for OPC-OA. And so in total, we have, so my number I got is 26 working groups. Perhaps it's a little bit different that not all at the moment are joint working groups. So you mentioned 22, but I think this is really changing, I think, each month. And also a good number is that over 450 companies are involved. And this is from the different sectors. So we have IT companies, we have from automotive, the classical mechanical engineering, and also end users here working together. VDMA basically is, yeah, as the name says, the D stands for Deutsch German Engineering Association, but a few years ago we already opened, so also European members, European companies can get member. But we have all over the world our connections to other associations on the European level sector committees, but also then here as an example from the machine visions, where they are in cooperation with US, Japan, China, to say, okay, we want to have these specifications worldwide standardized, so it does not make sense to make here a German or only European work. And then we have all around the world different specifications, so it really makes sense to work here together and to have worldwide unique standards. So we as VDMA, we want then to be the global partner for international companies, so international companies find partners also within VDMA so that we can open the doors to the networks, and by covering such broad field of machinery branches, also to say, okay, we can do cross-checks and also serve a little bit as quality assurance of the developed standards in our house. So the overview where you can find the different working groups, the activities, also the drafts, which are available on the website opcua.vdma.org. So this is over all branches collected the activities. So then, as I'm working for plastics and rubber machinery, I will give you some more details about this Euromap activities. So first, who is Euromap? As I mentioned, that is a European umbrella organization, and which accounts for some 40% of the worldwide production and 50% of the export volumes. So we have around 1,000 companies here under Euromap. And yes, you see the member countries listed there. And the activities besides this technical recommendations, which is also then the standardization in the field of OPCOA, also market information, support of exhibitions. So really what, yes, associations do. And this technical recommendation to do standards has a quite long tradition. So I went down to the archive and said, okay, what was the first interface I found? And it was this one for thermocouples, released October 1988. So how it was done at this time, we have an industry plug, and then it was defined, okay, pin number one, this signal, pin number two, that signal, and so on. Easy, reliable, was already a good step forward to say the different machine manufacturer use the same plug, the same socket, so that you can easily connect then here thermocouples to injection molding machines. So this for really field level, machine to machine, communication. I found also something for vertical communication, so injection molding machines and the central computer the same year, even a little bit earlier in May. Yeah, also state of the art in this year, you define bits and bytes. And of course, the technology has changed. And so also our Euromap recommendations have changed. So coming from this bit bus from Intel defining bits and bytes with already standardized plug, which was also an achievement, then going to data compatible interfaces so that text files are transferred via a network, now going really to semantic interface using OPCOA. And this, we can really drop off all these drawbacks we had, okay, limited address spaces, talking about numbers of bytes. Now we can have really semantic descriptions, good names of variables, methods, and events. And this was also then inside this first working group who dealt with injection molding machines, the central computer, the reason, okay, we want to use OPCOA. And this was before complete VDMA was working in such an intensity of this and said, okay, we prefer it as whole VDMA as standard. We already said plastic and rubber machinery, we want to try it, to use it. And yes, now looking back, it was a very good decision. Then presentation is called Chances and Challenges. So really to say, okay, first good chance was to have the support from the OPC Foundation. So this was right from the beginning. So the project started really earlier. It was 2014 when we had our first meetings And then in the early meeting, often we get really support from the OPC Foundation. I didn't know anything about OPC before, and then someone went to our meetings, explained, okay, how the modeling works. And then 2017, we made the signed a memorandum of understanding, and then also then this year, setting up as a joint working group with the OPC Foundation. A challenge what we face is, yeah, we do not want to have a mess of data. It is possible if you, some years ago, some manufacturers from the trade shows told me, okay, customers came and said, yes, I want to buy Industry 4.0 from you. And they asked, yeah, what do you want to do? Yes, I want to have the data. Yeah, which data do you want? What do you want to make with this? I can give you every second 500,000 variables, but you really have to look, okay, what do you want to do with this? Again, perhaps in the future, just put everything just somewhere in the cloud and have some algorithms and then find out what is the best way to produce with the machines. But I think this is a little bit in the future. So really we said, okay, and this is also then a chance, we can throw this away and make structured data models, and not only data models, so giving data the meaning, and that means that we have information models. And then we started here, called this Euromap 77, injection molding machine, to a central computer, to an MES. What are the important data we want to have there? Of course, we looked on our old standards, what we had already there, but when we took the chance to extend this, to have it more flexible, by this object-oriented modeling we have, by using methods, by allowing complete file transfers for setting programs on the machine, and so we built our first model here. And this is then challenge and change at the same time, that you have this multiple use cases that you have to think about, okay, what do you want to have in the standard? Perhaps not to do too much in the beginning so that you can bring something to the market and not to say, okay, I want to cover everything in the first version and then you need some years more. So already this first version took us 4 years, also based that there were was only few experiences in OPC-UA. Now this is getting better, but it's not only talking about OPC-UA, the technology when developing such a companion specification. It's really the discussion, the different machine manufacturers, different understandings of terms when you talk with each other, when you talk with a machine manufacturer and an MES supplier, what is a job? They have a different understanding. If you talk with a machine injection molding machine manufacturer and a robot manufacturer and talk about a running program, different understanding. And this is why it's important to bring those companies together to find a good understanding together and then finally put it in a model. So what we have covered at the moment is first the basic information about the machine. So, yeah, starting what is coming from OPCDI, manufacturer, model serial number, and so on, but also then the current configuration, what mold is installed, and then also error information and the production status. Then really to have the possibility to get the process values, so what are the temperatures, what are the pressures with which the parts are produced. Then going to job management, after we had this agreement, what we understand under this job, that we can send them from the MES directly to the machine. Also, if we have complex job sequences, so for example, not injection molding machines, but extrusion, where you, for example, also produce pipes and say, okay, I have fixed diameter pipes, so it's an endless production, but then you cut it in perhaps different length and you want to cover this. Management of complete data sets, recipes, programs, I already mentioned, and also on the horizontal level that a machine can set values on another peripheral device, for example, a temperature control device next to an injection molding machine, that injection molding machine also via OPC OA can set the temperatures. A challenge what we have is, okay, injection molding machine manufacturers here, for example, are working together, but what is the injection molding machines? We have some for some €1,000 up to some €1,000,000. We have producing small parts and very fast for the caps, for example, up to big parts for automotive. And the goal was to have one interface for all. And another challenge, how to find good system borders. So say, okay, talking about an extruder. So extruder is something you put some plastic granule in, and then it is melted, and then goes through a die, and then it can become a pipe, a profile, but also a foil, or it's just for mixture, then it's again granules that go out. So such an extruder stands never alone. You need something to get the material in, and then all after it is melted, to bring it in shape, to wind it up, for example, if it is a foil. And that means we have different components, and then we really had a longer discussion first, where does one component start, where does it end, and how to put this in the model. The first, say, okay, that's always an extrusion line, and then all components inside, but the components themselves can have OPC servers, and they want to directly send their data. Others say, okay, they first send their data to a line controller. The line controller collects everything and sends then the data to an MES. And then also the different components can communicate under each other, that, for example, the winder in the end wants to know the speed of the extruder to adjust also the speed. And this is why we decided here to have a modular structure. So all the different components have several parts with own namespaces, so they are closed models. Of course, what is used in common, we put separately and then make references. I will come to this later. But first to say, okay, it's not one big model and one big node set, so really have that here split up, which has then the advantage if we update one component, it just does not affect the others. So to get a feeling about the timeline of the project, here's an example, our Euromap 77 project. As I mentioned, we started for 2014 kickoff. We started in a German-speaking group because this was quite new for me and also for the companies to say, okay, it's a little bit easier that we don't have the language barrier. But then after a year, we extended this to the European level. We also involved then MES suppliers. We also involved an end user. And then said, okay, after 2.5 years, we already had a first release candidate. Was first only World Euromap, was no joint working group with OPC Foundation. And we demonstrated this at the Plastics Show, the K-Show in Düsseldorf in 2016. But then as we had other projects started, we found out, okay, there is something we need to define in general and then just to reuse. And this is why we had a new project, the Euromap 83, where we have then different specification for them, the general application. So it's sorry, it's not on the next slide because the order had changed, but it will come, the explanation for this. This took some time, this restructuring. Then we also did plug fests for testing. So that meant we really brought the machine manufacturers, MES manufacturers together, and they connected the machine controls and the laptops and really to test in different combination, does it really work? And then finally in May last year, we published Euromap 77 as a Euromap release. Demonstrated this also at China Plus, and now we transferred it to the OPC Foundation. So that is at the moment as release candidate, OPC 40077, this specification, and that means the next year we will have then also on the international level, not only European, the first release. Important for us is really I cannot write the specification alone in my office. So I really need the support of the manufacturers, and there I was very happy that I got the support. They wanted to work together. Also, they are competitors. So you see here on the right side all major European injection molding machine manufacturers, also with, let's say, a little international touch. For example, Sumitomo, it was the German division, but I think, as you know, Sumitomo is a Japanese company, and also Fanuc involved in the working group, and also Lego as an end user to also see, okay, what are the requirements, what do they want to have. They have large machine parks in their factory with some hundreds of injection molding machines producing Lego bricks, and they want to connect these machines, and they just want to have the data. So this was the demonstrator I mentioned at the K-Show. It was just, in the socket below was a very small PC, and it was right on the fairground. We built up a network over the halls with 8 machines, took some basic data, and the message really already there was in 2016, okay, the manufacturers have agreed using OPC-UA, using the same model, and then you can get live data here from the different machines. This was a demonstrator with only limited few functionality, and then when we finished the model or had the release candidate, so the implementation started, then also the company says, oh, this is really also a challenge. Of course, as it was before, it was work to connect each individual MES system to an injection molding machine, because each machine delivers other data, the MES wants to have it in another format, and then you have to program it and just to use some printouts or data sets and handbooks, okay, which data do you find where? And this we do not have if we have it standardized. But to go from the left side to the right side, so the machine manufacturers said this took them more than 1 man year of work, because they really had to adapt the control system. It's not just drawing links, okay, I have this variable in the control system, I put this in my OPC variable. It is having some modified behavior, because we define some methods and events that must then also be implemented in the control system. We have some functionalities where a user input is needed. For example, if there is an error and there's a standstill at the machine, then the operator shall select a reason for the standstill, and now the standstill reasons are configurable via OPC-UA from the client. So that means the original machine manufacturer does not know what the user will enter and has to provide an interface that the operator can select something. So really something to do. You have additional system load, of course, if you run an OPC server in addition to your control system. But in the end, they said really it is worth all the work, because we save it later. It is then clear for us what we have to deliver, and it's clear for the MES suppliers what they get. And then this was such a plug fest where we tried out in different combinations, really building up small networks with the machine controls. Was glad that didn't bought the complete machines, also the controls, and so. But they had some simulations on it and really can test, do the values also really change when you set the machine to automatic mode, and is the behavior achieved, and is the understanding of the standard correct? And then, yes, the result was that it works. China Plus, just to mention, okay, this is where we also presented it. So there was a booth in cooperation with the organizer of the fair to show, okay, here the connection of the machines. So I mentioned the different projects, and also this is also a challenge. So we started with these two projects with our combination injection molding machine to MAS. Another project is a connection to robots, where we need then also real time. This alone is a challenge. And then we found really out, okay, there is something duplicated. We put this in the general type definitions. And now as we have more and more projects, they are using this general type definitions, but they are also extending this. So for example, for the peripheral devices, they started modeling something for energy consumption, for maintenance for their field, and they said, okay, we didn't have this in Euromap 77, but it is interesting also for other machines, so we put this also in our superordinate specification. So some examples, what we put here, so this is general machine information, also this maintenance energy, what we put there. This only in the Euromap world, plastic and rubber machinery, because this was my area of influence, but this is not the complete world. So we had then more and more activities in VDMA. Now you have seen the huge amount of working group, but already then we said, okay, there is something we have seen, okay, we have something that we need to model in a generic way. But then we have a working group for robotics, and there's an overlap with our interface. So perhaps there is something in common, and we could put it on an even higher level, and also in the interaction in cooperation with the OPC Foundation. So for this, we have to find procedures how to collect information that can be harmonized, generalized over these different levels. And then, of course, as on my first slide, we need this cooperation with international partners. It's a challenge to organize this, of course. We have to set up really the structures for this, but this is really also the chance to get everyone involved and to have worldwide standards. So this is why we have this joint working group. So this is all from the plastics and rubber machinery, and you have the contact of me and also my colleague who is also dealing with the projects, and then I will continue with some other projects in VDMA. So the first part of OPC-UA for robotics is already released, and when you look at the motivation they had, it is quite similar as we had for plastics and rubber. There was no existing vendor independent standard. They wanted to integrate robots from different manufacturers in one system, want to exchange data with MAS or also for production controllers. And they also saw, okay, OPC-UA provides a lot of standard mechanism to use this. And especially the semantics already provided is a big benefit. And they also said, okay, we want to make robotics ready for Industry 4.0. They started February 2017. Also, when you see the core members, the big names, KUKA, Yaskawa, also control system, Beckhoff, also end user, WV, Volkswagen involved, and they could then really present this companion specification for robotics. They also started with one use case. They said, okay, first is the vertical integration, and then other functionalities will follow. And here you also see they needed 13 face-to-face meetings. It's not just saying, okay, let's sit together 1 or 2 days and then we agree on an information model. It's really a lot of work, and then we as also association, really have to say thank you to all these companies putting their workforce inside this working group. It's not the travel cost, is already, it's the time. It's often two-day meetings. It means often 3 days they are out of office, and the work they do not do then, they have to do before and afterwards. So really very good. We are very happy that we get the support also here from all these companies. So in the specification of the robotics, they also had to deal with different kind of robots. So they had to find a general model, because we have, yeah, this X-axis robot, you have linear robots, and so on. And so they had to find a mechanism to deal with several control users, with several peripheral devices, and they defined then this concept of so-called motion device systems, which consists then of a control system and the mechanical system. And in their first part, they covered now the condition monitoring, so they get the status of the components inside the robot, and the asset management, really to identify. And there did a presentation, the first presentation, at Automatica. So this picture already shown. I think this demonstrator was now shown several exhibitions to see, okay, it really works here in a small demonstrator production cell to be controlled via OPCOA. Contact for this working group is Mr. Supratik Banerjee. I just called him Sup. And if you have deeper questions to these activities. Another release is the OPCOA for machine vision. So what is machine vision? It's a system, not only a camera, also the software logic behind it, that you, for example, here identify which places in the box, where is the bottle, where is the cap on the bottle. Different technologies you have, different sensors and so on, and also the wish to put it into one system. Again, the same, we built up the joint working group with OPC Foundation to get the support, had core working groups with the major players here. They also had then a total working group with in total 60 stakeholders. Started 2017, and then also now the first release. And they really had to focus on the functionality, because it was hard to say, okay, each vision system consists of this and that. It was a little bit easier for the injection molding machines to say, okay, you have a unit where you melt the plastics, and you have the mold where you put the plastics inside, and the finished parts fall down or are taken by a robot. Here, we need to say, I need a generalized model to have some configuration put into a black box, and I get but standardized data outside. And this group is also led by SUP. So the design changes a little bit, because this is now from the machine tools. They are combined with VDMA, but also a separate association, the VDW, and they created also a brand, UMATI, as Universal Machine Tool Interface, which currently has the stage of a prototype, and they want to do a little bit more than just writing a companion specification. So they want to have larger framework, also then having some standardized connectors, or giving some standardized rules how to use the specification in the server, so to make it even easier to integrate different machine tools in one system. And this, I think, is at the moment one of the really larger working groups, so 85 members, combined from machine builders, software suppliers, and research institutes, end users, control manufacturers, all really here working together on one standard. They have quite a long list of use cases. They plan to cover. They have not covered all. But here again, you see overview parts in the job, status of the machine tool, overview errors and warning. We are repeating the things. Yes, we have different branches, we have the different projects. It was very good to have this front runners. These projects were the front runners in VDMA to get the experiences, but then we need to say, okay, there needs to be some combination. Very big showcase of Umati, of the machine tools, was just a few months ago at EMO Hannover, and they achieved to connect over 100 machines via a cloud, but via OPCUA in their system. They created an app where you as visitor could all the time see, okay, can connect to the machine, see is it producing, what's the status, and so on. And here, if you want more information on Umati, then best go directly to the website they have. So, the plant harmonization. So really we can say, what have we achieved? We have achieved to have this agreement on OPCUA, which is already a big success, not to have different systems compared to all this field buses on the lower level where there is no agreement. We have here an agreement on this higher level that you want to exchange data via OPCUA. We bring the competitors together to create common models, to create common understanding, and we have already shown that it really works in real life. Okay, that means real life. It's sometimes laboratory, plug fest, but also demonstrators on a fair, which is then more real life because it's not so easy to create a network on a fairground. But there are already now machines on the market sold with the companion specification for injection molding machines. But the different working groups created individual models, and they still create because they are in parallel. They have different modeling approaches. Some focus more really on the components the machine consists of. Some focus more on the functionalities. Some use a combination. And then really to say, okay, we need a harmonization to say between this general OPCUA model and the companion specification, we need to insert an OPCUA for machinery is our working title. We have started the work there, started with creating a common model for identification, are involved in the harmonization activities with the OPC Foundation, also this mentioned asset management workshop, to say, okay, when you buy a machine which has then the label supporting OPCUA for machinery, what kind of label it is, it's not really defined now, but then to say, okay, you will find everywhere at the same place, no matter what kind of machine is, the basic identification, in the future perhaps, and also the maintenance status, the error status, energy consumptions, and then only what is really special for a machine type is put into the special companion specifications. So, I think I'm good in the time so that I can come to my conclusion. So really, the standardized interfaces are the prerequisite for efficient network, and OPCUA is suitable framework for this, not providing only a protocol, providing really the complete framework. We have the companion specification, so OPCUA as a technology to have to be interoperable, the companion specifications to have the semantic interoperability, and then even when we have this harmonization only on a higher level, but this is now really our big task that we need this and will be essential for our success. So again, my contact data, I also added the contact data of my colleague Haiwa Hasegawa, the colleague here in Japan from our VDMA office, so perhaps sometimes a little bit easier to ask some question directly in Japanese, and then you can forward it to me, or you can directly contact me. Thank you very much.